What's up, guys, and welcome back to Watsy Subbuteo Show with myself, Watsy, and my good friend there, Martin O'Bradley. How are you, mate?
All's good, in the hood.
First off, happy anniversary, mate.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Happy birthday.
Thank you very much. 30. Oh, yeah.
30-ish.
Here, nice weekend, or nice couple of days away, I'm sure. Didn't think about Subbuteo, did you?
No.
Not one bit.
Didn't think about Subbuteo or fantasy field soccer or anything.
Get to the fantasy field soccer in a second, so we will. Last week's guest, Dave Gladman. Thanks very much, Dave. It was a huge success. This week, we're going to cover beginners, people getting into a club for the first time. So, guests will reflect that, so we will. So, we'll have a nice wee chat with a guest about joining a new club. So, the only other thing to do now is get into the old fantasy football, see who won the monthly prize. So, here comes fantasy football. All right. So, top of the table still. Emma Eckroyd is still top of the table on 422 points. We Are Groot is in second, so there's no change there. He's 2 points behind her. He's still on the sofa. He'd be off the sofa, wouldn't he?
He's out. He'd be out.
He'd be out if he goes above her. He was saying last week that he said online that he doesn't, he didn't go to Bristol because it's like a fucking 200 mile journey or something, round trip.
No, he says he doesn't go to Cardiff.
But it was Bristol. Yeah. It was Bristol's.
Bristol's in England. Cardiff's in Wales.
Bristol's in
England. Bristol's in England, Dick, yeah.
Geography. Help us out here. Right, well, he didn't go. That's why he didn't go. So, yours just as bad getting Wrexham and Cardiff mixed up. Thomas Regan, badly drawn Blues, is in third. John Henson, Trust John, is in fourth. He's up to fourth. He got 64 points. Paddy McKeever's dropped. Gary Nolan is staying sixth. Thomas O'Flaherty is seventh. I Love Hazard is in eighth. Paul Riddler, ninth. Barry Spence has dropped to 10th.
Oh, fast.
Martin Belfontaine is up to 11th. Remember, he was struggling at the start.
Slow burner.
Slow burner up to 11. He's going well. I wonder where his son is. Where is he? The great hope. He was doing everything. He was beating everybody.
Is he getting on?
Chikatikateka is 27. He's above you. You dropped the 30th.
The fuck?
I've dropped the 20th.
How'd that happen?
I've dropped the 23rd.
I was above him by fucking like 3 or 4 men last week.
You're 30th now. So I think the highest points, everybody seemed to score about 40, 35 to 40 points. I Love Hazard got 65 points and Martin Belfontaine got 62. Now, here is the moment of truth for the monthly prize. Sponsored by Wobbly Hobby Shop. £30 gift voucher for his store. Overall winner goes to... No way. Out of nowhere. Martin Belfontaine.
Ah, fuck off. How come your woman that's up at number one doesn't win it?
He beat Gary Nolan by a point because he got the most points.
How come your woman that's number one?
Hey, because he got the most points for September. 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 It's a monthly prize.
When did the whole thing start?
August. Alan Lee, you'll probably see him somewhere. You can just give him the voucher instead of us.
Interesting fact. Interesting fact was presented to me the other night.
What?
My good lady wife speaks French, you know.
Right.
Martin Dieu de Belfontaine. You know what that means? You know what that translates as?
What?
Martin, God of the Beautiful Fountains.
You don't seem to believe that.
That's what it means.
You seem to be
Elliot. Elliot, God of the beautiful fountain. God of the beautiful fountain. Jude Bellefontaine.
We have some French viewers, so maybe they'll clarify. Hope you're way straight.
I don't know. What way are you disputing that?
I'm not disputing it. I'm just saying.
You don't even know where fucking Bristol is.
Bristol's in Cardiff or in Wales.
Bristol's in fucking England.
No, it's on the border. On the border.
Answer's in a fucking postcard. Welsh. Bristol's in England.
Get your wee control panel.
Google it. Fucking Google it.
Google it on your...
Oh, spoil the Wi-Fi.
Right.
Fucking Googling it.
Speaking of the Bellefontaines, we found out who Bob was.
Hey.
I found out who Bob was. It wasn't Bob Varney. It was just a regular Bob that showed up at the competition and beat Elliot. Elliot had a play with
Bristol. Bristol.
Yes.
I can't. City in England. I don't even think it's near fucking Wales. Do you know where it is? Fucking Wales. Oh, I'm seeing.
This is great. This is great.
Near fucking Wales. This is
great. Where am
it's
I?
Not a kick in there, South Wales. It's not a kick in there, South Wales.
Ah, there you go. It's the same Wales.
But it's in fucking England.
Ah, well. It's close. Close. Right. Only one person to find out who's hot or who's not. That's our Oisin Moore. And by the way, viewer discretion is advised, as there's going to be a revealing photo of Oisin coming up.
Is he in the note?
No. We'll show us who's hot and who's not first. Here we go. Check it out. Sex bomb, sex bomb. Well, you're my sex
bomb. You can give it to me when I need to come along. Well, Karja, Falta Gajimo, Ray and Ashart. And you're well, folks. Very welcome to my Who's Hot and Who's Not for this week. My Who's Hot is Andrews Townsend of Everton. My granddad's old team used to play in this for them before the war. May well rob United of the points this weekend. And Harry Kane, he's my who's not this week, since his big money move has been a bit of a 007. No goals, no assists in 7 games. Hasn't been doing it at all since the move. August Shinaid on Chart and Shaw Harja, Jeepin' Shipin' Chart and Shaw Queen. That's it for this week, folks. Slán August Bannert.
Thank you, Oisin. And I'm sorry to do this, but I have to reveal this fantastic photo of you. Catalog pose for Derry City's Table Football Club. The sexiest photo you ever watched. Here we go. Look at this guy. Loving it.
I'm getting the swoons.
Kids,
all the ladies will be getting the swoons.
Kids, watch this. So, thank you, Oisin. And that's fantasy football for this week. Get your team sorted, everybody, for next week. New month. New sponsor coming next week, so we'll let you know who's sponsoring and what the prize is next week. So I want to introduce our new guest, our first guest, our new latest guest, whatever you want it to be, our guest.
Ladies and gentlemen, one of the newest Subbuteo players on the scene, Mr. Jude Morrow.
Welcome, Jude. Welcome, Jude. Nice to finally get you on the show.
Yes. Thanks. Thanks a million, lads. It's only been nearly 2.5 seasons.
He was on it. He was on it before.
No, I was not on it before. I had a token.
Excuse me.
I was an extra.
Were you on it before Christmas?
Were you on the Christmas special?
But I didn't have my own segment like this. I didn't have the spotlight for me.
We Benji and Elliot, the god of the beautiful fountain.
Discovered tonight.
I didn't have my own segment, and I have it now, so it's been nerve-wracking. I've been thinking about it all day, well, since 3 o'clock, since Lawrence asked me to do it, because I wasn't even the fucking first choice anyway.
Well, you're here, so
The boy he's actually wanted dropped out, and then I just shimmied in here.
Well, you were on the schedule. You came in a week early, so...
I was on for next week. That is this channel's version of the dog at my homework. Seriously.
Lawrence forgot to book a guest.
No. We won't go there.
Who'll be hanging about? We know how to do.
We won't be going there. We won't be going there. Martin Ogue. Spoke to a guest. organized the guest, and then when I said Martin Ogan's the guest ready, he says, "All right, I didn't organize the guest." So we'll not dwell on it.
I do believe it's called Watsy's Subbuteo Show.
But at the same time,
very clear to everybody involved that I have no creative control over the whole enterprise.
But at the same time, Martin Ogan, Jay Leno didn't get his own guests. He had people doing it for him. Or Ellen DeGeneres doesn't have their own guests.
There you go. There you go.
Know, so basically, well, what we're saying, Lawrence, is
somebody do it for him.
You may get an executive producer, I think they're called.
I thought Bradley was my executive producer, but he's just showing himself. It's too late there. Everybody at home has seen him for what he is. Right, nothing at cheat. Subbuteo, Jude. We call you a beginner. Well, you're obviously not a beginner because you've been playing about 3-4 years now, haven't you? But
3-4 years? No, about 2 years.
Fucking hell. Yeah, yeah.
Well, there was 18 months of lockdown, so you only joined about a year before lockdown, didn't you? Really?
I just before that, my first Subbuteo tournament, the first time I flicked a player was in March 2019 was the first time I ever played Subbuteo, ever.
And now it's, what, 21, so 2 years plus a lockdown, so you are pretty new, like.
A complete novice. I'm a complete nobody. I mean, as far as guests, like, for this, I mean, fair enough. I've never won anything. I've barely won a few matches, barely scored a few goals, and then here I am. But I enjoy it. That's the main thing.
That's the thing. We're trying to get people to go to clubs and get out of their attics and go and join a club instead of playing on their own. So what was your experience when you decided... Or how did you find, obviously, Martin Ogue through work, but how did you find it coming as a first-timer?
It was one of those things that I enjoyed it 10 times more than I thought it would, where I used to see these videos where Martin Ogue and I shared an office, and I knew that Martin Ogue met up in a pub with a bunch of other, you know, aging men, you know, as in 40-plus, meeting up to play what is, in essence, a child's game. So I thought, this has really piqued my curiosity. And then I watched it and watched it and watched it. And I thought, I think I'd be good at that. I want to give it a go. And then Martin Ogue asked me to come along one night. And I was just hooked. That was it. I thought, I really like this. And then it's, in a lot of ways, it's sort of consumed bits of my life that were once important. But I've replaced it with Subbuteo now. So I'm enjoying it.
And talk us through... your obsession with Roy of the Rovers, where does that come from, or how?
The Roy of the Rovers link comes from my dad, who was a diehard fan, would have as a collector of things like magazines, and his main things were Empire magazine and the Roy of the Rovers magazine. So it was about sort of whenever I was growing up, where he tried to get me into it whenever I was young, but then I kept telling him to wise up. And wasn't interested, but I still remember that. There's a nostalgic feeling to it, and it just sort of grew from there, where I inherited, well, not inherited, because my dad's still alive. Like, I got all of these magazines because there was nowhere else to put them, and my ma kind of said, the magazines go or you go, and obviously he made, well, probably the right choice and got rid of the magazines, and then they ended up in my house, and I have, you know, all these magazines, and they're all in pristine condition, and I noticed the Subbuteo connection in that first, because even as far back as even as the 1960s, there's always been a Subbuteo link with Roy of the Rovers. Like, there was coupons and magazines, and I just felt it very fitting that that's what my Subbuteo team would be the Melchester Rovers teams.
So did you have any, like, most people come on the show have played Subbuteo from they were like 10 to they were 15 or 16. Did you have any connection to Subbuteo at all? Did you
absolutely
know about it,
none,
or nothing? No,
absolutely none. I knew it existed, and I think whenever I was very young, maybe a friend of mine from childhood tried to get me to play it, and it wasn't like the flat good crack ones that exist now. It was the wobbly ones, and I think I took one flick and he fell over. And I thought in my head, I swear I'm never playing this ever again. Because with me, if I don't take to something right away, or I don't instantly like something, I lose interest. And but Subbuteo, whenever I sort of took it up at the very, very tender age of 29, then I just enjoyed it straight away. Not like whenever I was younger, because sure, Subbuteo was on its way out back then. Anyway, like, What year was I born? 1990. So.
90. It was sort of at its peak in 90, I think, with the World Cup.
Well gone. Going.
It was starting to go. Like even I don't even remember seeing it in toy shops. I mean, in the mid 90s or going on towards the end of the 90s. So it wasn't really a thing whenever I was growing up. But then, sure, the PlayStation came in then and wiped it out.
And speaking about playing, what have you noticed your game changing? I've noticed you getting better as the weeks and months have gone on after lockdown. You've been getting a lot better at your playing. The last time we showed highlights of you and Martin, you held Martin 0-0 at half time. Frustrated.
That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to think more tactically. I'm trying to think a couple of moves ahead because, you know what, believe it or not, I loved chess when I was younger. I'm still all right at it. But I've kind of applied that kind of mindset to Subbuteo, where trying to think as much ahead as I can. And then the more you play along with different people, you pick up what types of game that people play. So you go into the game feeling a bit more prepared. Like, I know Martin Ogue likes, you know, running up the pitch with his two wee men, you know, leaning towards the left-hand side. And then even with you, Lawrence, you set up, you have your three wee men, you know, just here on the left-hand side. So you pick up how people play, and I think that improves your game in return, where you sort of know what to expect. But, I mean, if you hatch plan B, I'm finished. I mean, I only know your plan A is for now, but... I mean, I'll get that in time, hopefully.
Well, not all of us have a plan. Like Martin's a player that can change a game any way he wants. I have a one style, and that's it. And it's just try and get up a pitch and score. But I think the last time we played here in my house, me and you drew 0-0. And then we played and they get Derry open, and we drew 0-0, and you could have scored in the last minute with an empty net, but you missed.
I know. That's the one thing where in my head. I don't know why I go in with a strategy is try and force an error as much as possible. Where everybody said to me at the start, if you learn how to block properly, then you'll be all right. And I think I've done all right with blocking, but unfortunately it's come at the expense of scoring goals. So I draw a lot. Like so,
you
I get a lot of scoreless
you
draws.
You shit the bed when you get a shot and shooting chance.
I do shit the bed, and it's not like, you know, a gentlemanly shit the bed. It's like proper up the back and dropping down to the floor shit the bed.
The bed needs dumped.
Like a newborn shit the bed, like it's just everywhere. Like shit the cot or shit the crib. I need to learn to shoot.
I've never seen a miss in Subbuteo like the miss you had against me in the Derry Open. If I can explain it, I use my goalie, miss the kick, goal kick. You had three shots to kick it in the empty net. You were in my 18-yard box. You took a touch. You took another touch. You set it up in the edge of the 6-yard box. And all you had to do was flick it into the empty net.
Yeah.
You flicked it. The ball rolled towards the net. And then just rolled back again.
Yeah. The ball stopped. It was like, do you remember that? Probably like people talk about the 2005 Champions League final, but the greatest ever football match ever to be played was the Craggy Island over 75s football match. You know, like the ball rolling really slowly. It was like that, and then the ball just stopped in the line and rolled back. Like you could recreate. Like, do you know what I've actually done in the house since? I have tried to recreate that moment where the ball doesn't go under the net, and I can't do it. Where any time I flick the ball, it just rolls under the net, and that's it, and that's me. I've won the match. But to have it stop on the goal line, I can't do it.
It was amazing. And you know what? It was the very last
second. You keep making chances in games, but it's always like that. You keep making chances. You get through. You work a play. You have a shot on, and you either jump, go too quick, or you wait too long, and then...
Yep. Thinking
too much about that last action.
Yeah, there's a Goldilocks position when it comes to scoring a goal in Subbuteo, where I remember one time I played Mark Farrell had said to me, you know, if you get a shooting chance, keep the momentum and take the shot reasonably quickly. Where if you've got the ball in there and your opponent's a bit flustered, working out their block flick or working out trying to defend, then just take the shot. More likely than not, it's going to go in. But then Barry Spence says, you're going too quickly, slow down. and then I slowed down too much. So I just need to get that Goldilocks position, and then I might be dangerous, and I might steal some more 1-0 wins. I'm like the Tony Pulis of Subbuteo. A lot of scoreless draws.
Just practice, mate. You just need to see what I do with the two men up the pitch. Just keep practicing that, taking your shots up and down. Practice. That's all it is.
There's a way lot of analogies here. There's a Goldilocks, there's a Tony Pulis.
Shite in the bed. But here's the thing though: is that say at home, I can pick a corner and it's in, but you can't recreate a match position. You can't recreate a match or a tournament situation where if you don't knock this in the net, you're not getting out of the group.
That's why you practice.
Well, look at that. Your man came up from Dublin.
Colm.
Came up. He'd been playing away on his own, and he was good. You could see that he'd been playing away, but it was when it came to defence, no defence. But if you practice your shooting, and you practice, and then when you're playing, opportunity arises, the point that you've practiced, then chances are you're going to get a goal.
Aye, I do. And you know what? I've been in a couple of good high-scoring games. I mean, I got a 2-2-2-all draw with Mark Farrell, and I don't care. Yes, he took it easy on me, but the result still stands, where I still had to kick it under the net. I still had to flick it in, and I managed to do that. Where even one game, I was thinking about it earlier because I was thinking, what good games have I played? I played a brilliant game with Oisin, and it was just before the lockdown. It was a high-scoring draw. I think it was either 2-each or 3-each, and Oisin had equalised literally with the last flick of the game. So another couple of things happened to me. I either take the lead and get excited and lose the lead, or I go behind and then I get annoyed, because that's what happens to me, where I'm doing really well and then a goal goes in out of nowhere, and then kind of psychologically I'm finished. I suppose a bit like Ronnie O'Sullivan.
You give up after that.
Aye, that's it. Ronnie O'Sullivan loses the first frame. That's it. He's lost the match.
You don't need the one.
They have had
a good game or a great score at the end. You know what I mean? The score means everything, but it doesn't tell the whole story.
That is true. But I enjoy it. I would say to anybody, where no doubt there's going to be curious people watching Subbuteo videos thinking, what are they doing? Like, what is this all about? Where go down. Like, You won't regret it, because I haven't regretted it. Like, I'm stuck with these forever now. And, you know, it is what it is. But, you know, it could be worse hobbies. It could be worse things every other Monday night.
That's what everybody seems to say. You know, when they do come along and join in, they'd be saying, oh, my wife's given off that I'll come down and play some video and travel 4 hours there and back and whatever else. Mm. And then they're saying, well, the other thing, I could be in the pub every night and you wouldn't see me, or if you spent no money on different things that aren't very
legal.
Cocaine and hookers. Cocaine and hookers. All right, I'm fucking Subbuteo with Grounder then. You're giving up. I could be having the life of fucking Riley, and I'm down there playing Subbuteo.
Aye, playing Subbuteo every other Monday night. But even whenever we're playing in the side room, like, you can see the curiosity from other people in the bar. Like, as the night goes on and more people have a few more beers, you see the curious eyeballs coming around the corner to see what we're doing.
Yeah.
And then people come in.
But that's what Alan Lee says, that the last time he was on the show, he says, that's where you need to stop your competition and get them to play. You know,
I disagree with that altogether.
See?
Fuck off.
But because you know what? Like, say as far as tables, like, I mean, we have more tables than Buckingham Palace. Like, why can't a spare table be set up with a couple of old, dodgy, fucking wobbly teams where if boys want to mess around, you know, flick a couple of men about, you know, flick a couple of balls under the net, then what's the problem there? Where the tournament can still go on, a couple of boys can mess about, and you never know. One person that could flick the ball about, like me, could think, you know what, I really like this, and come back the next week to even try and play in the competition. You never know.
There's a load of factors in that. For a start, the start of a competition, you're using all the tools. And then come later on in the game, the visitors aren't really that interested. And then as it moves on, the best matches being played, we're already starting to red up. You know what I mean?
But at the same time, though, if that doesn't exist, then the game will go extinct. Because, I mean, for me, the coming into it, where, yeah, like there's not many other people that have come into it. Yeah, there's been new people come to the club since. Yeah. But if there's not a vehicle or an opportunity for people to actually play the game while we're there, then... I mean, because you gave me that opportunity to play. You gave, like, I was curious about it, and I got to mess about with it and got to like it. And if more people got that opportunity, then you could see a bit of growth. Now, I'm not saying it's going to be like the biggest growing sport in the world. Like, it's not going to be the new darts or the new snooker, but it could be near enough. Like, it could be a pub game, a proper pub game.
What I was going to do.
It could be, but it won't be. You're an aberration. You're an aberration in Subbuteo. Somebody that never heard of it, never played it, happened to meet me, took up with it. Do you know what I mean? That's not going to happen. If that happens again, that's like one in the lotto. That'll rarely happen, if ever.
Well, what
we are in, Subbuteo is in the midst of the great extinction now. Do you know what I mean?
There's no going back. I could bring the old brandy wheel into the Derry City Club and ask Christy, look, I'm going to throw a table up in the studio on top of the pool table. If anyone wants to play it, there's two teams. There's two old shitty teams. Work away. Who do we sign up free to play? And see if you look in some night and there's two old boys running up and down the table playing away. You'd be like, happy days. That's, somebody's enjoying it. You're not going to get members out of that club that we play in, because most people who go into that club are in to get hammered and go home and not remember what they've done that night.
That's an awful thing to say about the DC club.
But hold on, Lawrence, right? I mean, you don't need that many people to make history, right? As the famous Tony Wilson once said, right? There was only 12 at the Last Supper, right? There was only, a few at Sermon on the Mount, and Archimedes was on his own in the bath. So if we set up every week, right? Right, hold on, back to more analogies, like Gandhi. Like, at one stage, God rest his soul, nobody really gave a fuck about Gandhi or his message, but he kept speaking in the same garden in Mumbai every single week, and every week he spoke and said the same thing, more and more people came along. So why can't there be somewhat of a Subbuteo about that? Like, it's not going to be Nebworth, or it's not going to be like a big festival or anything, but even if it was 5 or 6 more players, preferably under the age of 45, then it could be the legacy of the club, whereas it'll die with news oil fuckers.
Well,
Gandhi was out to change a country, change a society. He'd something to say that people wanted to listen to. Nobody wants to listen to boys talk about Subbuteo.
but I want to listen to people talk about Subbuteo.
Nobody wants to watch boys play Subbuteo. There hardly is anybody in the world.
Yeah, but what about this video, right? Where this video, you're getting about 300 views a week. And in the show, if you're saying, nah, it's too much setting up new tables, it's too much accommodating new members, we need to look after our own here, where we need to look after just our wee competition.
No. There's no. There's no not accommodating new members. There's no not accommodating anybody.
But then
you're the prime example of accommodation. Come on in.
I know.
Here's a team.
Yep.
Get in the car. Let's go. Aye. You know what I mean? There's no non-accommodation.
But
the thought that anybody's going to fucking breathe life back into the game of Subbuteo.
But that's the thing, is that retro is always
for a new generation.
Like retro is. Retro is always a good thing. Like, look at Lawrence Watson. Look at the corner of Lawrence Watson's living room. He is a vinyl player. Like, people are buying, like, the sales of LPs are going up. Where, there's a lot of revivalists for anything, where even classic cars, like minis or whatever, there's always enthusiasts. But if all the mini owners thought, you know what, fuck everybody else, nobody new is going to buy a mini or take any interest in it, then all of their owners' clubs would just die out. And that would be that, the end of it.
Well, the demographic for buying vinyl is, that's his age. That's where all the sales of vinyl are coming from. That generation that had vinyl when they grew up. I have a 15-year-old down there. Don't know what a record is. Has no interest. Couldn't give a shit about it. Record player. That's stupid. That's what she would say. That shit's stupid.
But even
money, who do you think is buying monies? What age of boys is buying monies? Why do you think they're a dying breed? They're in their fucking 15s. They're not in their 20s. They haven't just passed their test and they're all now looking at vintage fucking money.
Well, sorry.
Bad
example, right? What about retro football jerseys? Where I'm sure Lawrence Watson has a Celtic rig with Carling written across the front. Where you can buy
what age is Lawrence? What age is Lawrence Watson?
Jesus,
what do you look at him and think he's in his fucking 20s? He's a 40-year-old man.
I'm 30.
That's who's buying retro jerseys. People buy fucking Pokemons. I couldn't give a shit about fucking Pokemons. Do you know what I mean?
Bradley, sort your connection
out. I'll buy a 30. You? What's wrong with my connection?
But
freezing.
But what my point is that the reason why I got into Subbuteo is because I was accommodated and facilitated messing about with it first and playing it. Because if you said to me, come along to this competition, of course it's going to deter people. People are going to think, no, this is quite elitist and exclusionary. Then people aren't really going to get into it. Where if there's like a bit of not a free-for-all, like there still has to be a bit of structure. I mean, if anybody loves structure in the world, it's me. But I mean, to have the option of people coming along, messing around with nothing at stake or nothing to lose, or, you know, without feeling they have to compete or be embarrassed by people who've been playing it for years and years and years and years. Then I think that's how it's going to grow.
I don't think we have the opportunity. We're putting something on, and there's boys traveling from all over the country. You know what I mean?
Mm.
So we are kind of looking after our own being the Subbuteo players. You know what I mean? By all means, anybody else, come on in. But we're not. I don't think we should change it to try and drag somebody in.
I think we should say,
can I have a game? Can I get a go?
Aye.
Come on in.
But it's not like dragging people to be through it. Like it's like holding the door open for them as opposed to shoving somebody through it. Where it's always nice to have the option for if new people want to come along. Because even looking at our own Subbuteo club page, where it does get engagement, it gets a lot of likes. The live streams get a lot of views on them. And I mean, there could be somebody watching that.
It's all Subbuteo people.
But I was watching that before I got into it, and I wasn't a Subbuteo person. I was a curious person. Where you
were watching enough. That? You were watching that because I made you like it.
right, boys. That's.
I made everybody like it, so we got the likes up.
You're gonna end up ruining the good fucking game. You're fighting against each other, arguing against each other. What?
Who are you to talk about arguing?
We're trying to promote people into the club.
The fuck is the video community?
We're trying to promote people to come to the club, and Martin Oakes saying, nobody want people to come to the club. Stay away.
In an ideal world, we'd have a Subbuteo tournament and a table set up and somebody roping in punters. Come on, have a go. Have a wee look. Here's a flyer. Read up about it. Take a badge.
We're not talking about holiday reps in Benidorm.
Have a badge.
There's going to be people interested, but to promote engagement in the comments, it would be brilliant to see what people think. To see who won.
Right. Well, let's wrap it up because
you're flogging a dead horse. Everybody's flogging a dead horse. You should just enjoy what you have and get on with.
I was chatting because Lawrence is shiting himself because he knows the Celtic match is starting now and he wants to wrap it up and I'm keeping on going. And the more I'm talking, the more anxious he's getting.
They're getting beat 2-0.
Who's beating them? Rangers?
No, Labour Rangers. Leverkusen. Right. Jude, thanks a million for coming on. I appreciate you coming in last minute. And thank you for sharing your views as a beginner and coming into the club. Thank you for arguing with Martin O'Bradley.
As always.
I don't believe it was an argument. I don't believe it was an argument.
It was a gentlemanly debate.
Well,
which I won by far.
I'm rarely wrong, so I'm usually
you're
right.
You're our new PR, PR manager.
Balance of probabilities.
Pleasure, right, lads.
Dude, thanks a million, mate. Appreciate
pleasure,
it.
Lads. All right, bye-bye, mate.
Right, thank you.
Enjoying yourself. Thank you, Jude.
So here this week, I'm going to come back. Well, there's no What's in Your Box with Jude because Jude done us a What's in Your Box a few months ago, so we've already got it. So this time we're going to do match highlights for Bologna. Included in the match highlights will be a wee bit of a video diary from Elliot and the boys who
Elliot,
were there. So
Elliot,
Jude de Bellefontaine. I don't know what he is. The handsome,
beautiful fountain.
Well, here he is.
Elliot, God of the beautiful fountains.
This is courtesy of Elliot and Alan Lee and a wee bit of Chris Thomas. So check it out. Here you go.
Where's your team, Zell?
I've
got a caddy.
My caddy's
holding
it.
You gonna win today?
No. Of course not. I'm gonna smash everyone. That way.
So Daniel Sheen? Are you going to win today?
I hope.
which opponents are you fearing the most, apart from me, of course?
There's a lot of players. Matteangeli, Calonico, Camilleri, Pisani, Alessi, Torano, Lazzaretti. They are all very good players, and nobody knows who will win. And I hope I will be in this package.
Excellent. Have a good day, yeah?
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Talk to you later.
Have you achieved what you set out to achieve?
Yeah, I lost every game, but I scored a goal. And I've had a great time, and I met some lovely people.
So, what were your scores?
2-0. Should have won that one. 4-0. To the ex-world champion.
Should have won that one as well. Should you have won that one as well?
You know what? I had 3 or 4 good chances.
So you still would have won.
Do you know what? It could have been a better game for me. Last game, 6-1. Scored a great goal, but the guy was just brilliant.
Christian Haas, the number one player in Royal Casemiro. How did you get on today?
Good. Perfect. Playing with figures.
Playing with figures, that's always good.
As I didn't play for 588 days. So this is why I
played. 588?
Yeah.
That's a lot of numbers.
Yeah.
And how many games did you win today?
Two. In the group stage, two.
Group stage, okay, that's good.
Two and one draw.
And then how many after the group stage in the knockout rounds did you win?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, that's a touchy subject, I forgot about that. Unfortunately, Chris didn't get through the group stage.
Yeah.
Just yet? Is that all you've got to say?
That's it.
Okay, lovely.
I'm still checking, I don't know where it is.
So, Chris, how did you go on today?
That was balanced. Average.
Totally average. Don't say average, because I came out of the round before you, so.
Oh.
How was your riffing?
Hopeless. My riffing?
Yeah, your riffing.
As bad as the riffing that happened in my
own. So what happened in your riffing?
Well, Elliot interfered with a beer.
That's always the right thing to do.
Got it all wrong.
Yeah.
And made me give a free kick when it was actually a back.
Okay.
But I didn't know who it was a back to.
And who plays your riffing?
Remy Huth.
Poon.
What's the surname?
H-U-Y-H-N or
something. So I was kind of prick.
Yeah.
And some guy from Greek.
And who did you lose to today?
Shovel.
Oh, okay, shovel.
just if you want to, if you're video and you want an idea of how his blocks go, like something like this.
Great block, Mark.
Don't show Mark this. It's your
Mark doesn't watch What's the Subbuteo channel. But yeah, that's your week. All good. So great weekend.
Happy days.
Lovely.
Right, mate, how you doing? We're now in the evening after the Open tournament.
In Bologna!
And yeah, it's a great tournament. I don't know how many people got videos and photos and stuff like that. In my group, I end up winning it, which was very surprising. Three wins out of three. And then lost in the barrage round, which was a bit annoying. But finished above my teammate, which is always good. As he eats food. But yeah, I hope this has been a while for you, mate. And see you soon. Cheers.
Welcome to Bologna, Chris Thomas, one of England's top players. What do you think of the Keith Littler scandal, Chris?
Well, I need to know who's first.
Thank you, boys. Looks like you had a great weekend, despite the results. So, talking of results, Martin O'Gradley, here's your piece where you shed some light on what's going on around the globe. What do you got for us?
Well, where do you want to start?
You start. Do you have any Bologna?
Geography,
there?
Man.
Have you any Bologna?
No. No. I've no Bologna.
Can you go to Bologna. Vincent in Belgium, who lives? Is Belgium part of France?
No. He lives in Tempelhove.
Tempelhove, Belgium.
I've got nothing for Vincent. Have you anything for Vincent?
Well, this goal from Vincent, he scored at the weekend. Obviously, he doesn't have his results up from the tournament. So, check out this wee goal from Vincent Copano. As you will see, it is absolutely outstanding. Here we go.
Has Vincent coming at you? Eh? Has Vincent running up the pitch at you?
I've scored a few of them today. Definitely have. Go on then. What have you got for us? Go anywhere. Okay, go wherever you want.
North of England.
North Shields.
North Shields, Subbuteo Club, Table Football Club, and a wee Wasper, three-man Wasper, and Chris Cabry, top the table. Congratulations, Chris.
Well done, Chris.
Who do you beat? Nigel LeMond.
Oh.
I always hear his name and I think, is he Mr. LeMond that made the Subbuteo mind?
Oh, that's Paul LeMond.
I don't think so, but maybe Paul he's LeMond. Like his son or his brother or something. Or his
could be something. Could
nephew,
be
some sort of relation.
Quite a famous name.
Where next? Where do we look?
This is your show. This is your part of the show.
Do we look around the globe? Do we go?
We hit
the Netherlands.
Yes.
Not sure if it's Holland or the Netherlands.
the Netherlands.
Subbuteo, Netherlands. They had a wee Wednesday night Waspa. And Fabrizio Cavazza, he won.
Very nice. Well done, Fabrizio.
They have a new competition, next competition, Sunday, 10th of October. So if you're local.
Anybody about Amsterdam or Holland, Netherlands, anywhere?
Don't know where it is.
Right, where
do you
want
to go next?
You work away, sir. Whatever you want.
Saying we're in Singapore now.
Oh, that's hello, some, hello. That's some hike.
Hello, hello.
Singapore.
That's a queer jump, isn't it?
That's some jump.
Singapore is a big Subbuteo community in Singapore. Very popular game in Singapore. Lots of clubs play all around the country. But current COVID restrictions, the most people they can have at a competition is three people at a meeting.
Seriously?
So they're having loads of... three people indoors. So they're having loads of wee mini tournaments around the show. So the first one was held in the Sports Hub Library. Don't know where that is. I don't know which club were on it. But the winner was Toon Kok Wee. Plays for Singapore Lions. It's a video club.
Well done.
Are you laughing at? Are you laughing at?
No.
That's funny.
I just expected you to get that wrong. Well, you done well. I don't know. This your pronunciation is very good.
I can read and write.
Go on, glad you're doing.
So the second of the three mini tournaments.
Yes.
Was held by the Dragons Subbuteo Club.
Yes.
Also, I think around the same area. Winner last time was Rudy Hestie Roseland, which is very good. He plays for Jurong Central Subbuteo. I think he's Asian champion, you know, Rudy Hestie. Not
very
too
good.
Sure.
Good.
And then the third one, the Lions Subbuteo Club. Held that. And again, three men. The winner, yet again. And Kok Wee.
Well done. Nice pronunciation.
From Singapore Lions.
Well done. So
what about
these
that?
Weren't obviously these weren't all played in the same day, guessing.
No, I don't think they were played in the same day. I thought it was one twice. That's all they can. They can only have three boys that are inside. So usually they have quite good turnouts.
That's what I mean. But if you set them up in a way that you could leave somebody's house or wherever, go to the next, you know, round robin. And always have three.
Could be
people.
Fucking 30 miles away. Could be 30 miles away. Could be fucking.
Well, you could stagger
Singapore's
the start.
Like, man, isn't it?
Stagger the start times.
I'm gonna slingshot back across the globe again. The one of England's most active, most definitely sexiest Subbuteo club in the UK. Liverpool Subbuteo club. No, I'm a liar. The sexiest man in Subbuteo played at this competition. Wasn't in Liverpool. Was London Road.
Oh,
our sister club. Our sister club had a tournament there just the other day. Who won? I spot the surprise.
Brian Daly.
Sexy Brian Daly. We sexy B won.
Well done, Brian.
Came after you just came second. Well done, Brian. Well done, Kane, second place.
Well done, Kane.
Ruby Matthews, Subbuteo sensation. World number one. Came on third.
How many was that at the competition? Three?
No, there was five.
Oh, very good. Good numbers.
Some new dudes. It's good.
Nick Pearson play?
No. No. Some other dudes.
Anywhere else? No?
No, that's it.
That's it. Thanks very much.
That's appreciate all right. It. That's quite a lot. That's four different clubs all around the world. Then we've been all around the world.
Took a while to get there with your Wi-Fi, you know. London Roads in
Wales.
Yeah, I know that. I know that. Even despite the name. It's very close to Liverpool. But... as you may remember.
It's very close to Liverpool.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember.
My geography's not that bad. Right, sir. Well, thanks very much for them results. See when you're done.
Still looking at that, Evan.
When you're done taping into our WhatsApp group there and stuff, can you concentrate with me in the show? Like, I can see your message appearing on the screen. You know, that's fucking very fucking rude there. Very rude.
I did advise we were recording and couldn't chat.
Beat it. Beat it, would you? Get out of here. You obviously have more important things to do.
Well. Are you frozen?
No, I'm just in bewilderment.
You're just bewilderment.
That's your shocking Wi-Fi. Your Wi-Fi, your...
The Shed prioritizes the retro side of humanity over modern conveniences like internet and Wi-Fi.
Oh, here, I have a solo player.
Shed about light and Subbuteo.
Have a solo player lined up.
Magic. Is it what?
He's magic. I can't tell you who he is, but he's got lots to say.
What's his name?
A wee clip of him here. You wanna hear him speaking?
Go.
Right on.
Sounds good.
We'll get a chat to you next week. Take care, everybody. See you all next week. Oh. All right.